It's taken 4 years in the construction, but the reward is finally at hand. The Broncos have conquered the harassments, disappointments and hardships to reach the final step on the path to rugby league's ultimate prize, the JJ Giltinan Shield. Symbol of supremacy in one of the toughest and most demanding football competitions in the world, the New South Wales Rugby League Premiership. Non-existent in 1987, Brisbane's favourite Suns have evolved out of little more than pride and perseverance to take on and account for all comers. This program will track the club's rise from obscurity right through to the Sydney Football Stadium today, September 27, 1992, with the Brisbane Broncos bound for glory.
September 20, 1987. Brothers' victory in the Brisbane Grand Final closes the curtain on the old and heralds a changing face for the game in this state. The mecca of the rugby league world beckons. The competition was expanding and Queensland's proud tradition in the code would be represented. The Brisbane Broncos were conceived, but it was not to be a painless beginning for a club born against the odds. April 87 and the QRL had declined an offer to join the Sydney competition. The reasons not all that clear. QRL chairman Bill Hunter.
I'd say that the decision was made. It's as simple as that.
New South Wales General Manager John Quayle made his feelings clear when asked if he thought Queensland was behind the times.
Yes.
A $2 million bid by West Australian clothing high flyer Alistair Norwood forced a change of mind. With the door now ajar, the Barry Maranta Consortium made a successful move.
We felt that the overall financial picture, you know, was much better through the Maranta Group.
The ball now in the Broncos' court. Director Paul Morgan.
If we put a good product on the field, I think we'll get the support.
First priority is to make a profit or at least not make a loss. So that then, we ran our business plan off that, and that was to get the public back into watching the game. Therefore it had to be an entertaining type of football we played, and to get the ladies and the families back to rugby league.
With the license granted, a frenzy of activity ensued. John Rebo is appointed manager, Wayne Bennett coach, and the big three, Lewis, Miles and Dowling, signed contracts. The Broncos are off and running. However, the new boys on the block were not about to be treated with kid gloves. Their first premiership fixture on March 6, 1988 was against the league silver tails, reigning premiers, Manly Warringah.
Still alive though.
The Sea Eagles are thrashed 44-10, and the Sydney press is in raptures.
Broncos last night showed they were worthy of a place in the
winter. Two tries to sink the
Lang Park crowd was too much for the Sea Eagles to handle.
Four more wins follow, but dream time suddenly ends, and the nightmares begin. The Broncos' forwards are found wanting, losses mount, and the club's capacity to become embroiled in controversy starts when officials come under fire for using a Powers banner at Lang Park. Come September, the semi-finals start with the Broncos looking to the next season. Roll on, 89. Jacko signs up, and Brisbane gets off to the ideal start. They claim their first trophy with a win over Illawarra in the Panasonic Cup. They hold a top three position until rep commitments interfere. Five straight losses. The playing season ends with a defeat by Cronulla in the playoff for fifth spot.
It's just a shame we didn't make it, but I don't think we're going to get much sympathy down here.
Out of the running, but not out of the news. October brings the biggest controversy in the club's short life. Australian and Queensland captain, the Emperor of Lang Park, Wally Lewis, previously believed untouchable, is sacked as club skipper, replaced by close mate Gene Miles.
He said that he would support me, even though he's still very disappointed about losing the job.
The public of Brisbane expressed their views on radio talkback the following morning.
Look, mate, I'd just like to say, I think the people of Brisbane and Queensland should sort of get underway something to get Wally back as captain again.
I think he's been made a scapegoat, and I think they should have a good hard look at their coach.
1990 dawns brighter with the signing of Dale Shearer from Manly, and the Broncos again leave the gates at full speed. 11 successive victories include a long-awaited first win over Balmain. Two young tyros make a huge impact in their first year, Willie Kahn and Paul Hoff.
Support on both sides.
Brisbane finishes third, lose the major semi-final to Penrith, but bounce back with a great win against Manly to secure another chance of making the grand final. However, further Lewis-inspired controversy breaks in the days leading up to the preliminary final against Canberra. Arguably the Code's greatest ever player, Walter J. Lewis, announces he is quitting the club.
It's quite easily the most disappointing moment of my life. But I won't be saying any more than this, any more than expressing my disappointment.
The Raiders give Brisbane a belting. The one consolation? Ray Herring's reserve grade team snares a premiership.
One more, mate, please.
1991 begins with a bang. The Broncos claim their second Challenge Cup, but the season quickly turns sour.
Penal! Penal finds well set for the line! He gets it pass away! It's a tremendous George!
They fail to make finals. And two of the greats, Greg Dowling and Gene Miles, bow out of Australian Rugby League.
Lewis, a little chip. Well, it bounces off the upright, and they're in. Dowling has gone in, and it's up a Lewis kick, and that's got to be luck.
Wallace to Lewis, turns it back inside to Dowling. Dowling reaches for the line, and is there. Win, Murray. Kahn, back in field for Dowling.
The winter frolics might be over and done with, but summer does not spell sunshine and sailing for the Broncos staff.
Glenn Lazarus's shorts.
Gilbert Park is not just a clubhouse, it's a business address. And there's plenty of off-field work to be done if the four-year experience in the Sydney League was to reap the ultimate dividend in season 92. As well as the 65 players on the books, there's more than 100 staff employed by the football and leagues clubs. And patrons at Fulcher Road aren't only interested in the numbers on the scoreboard. And while the players aim to become the kings of the Sydney League, cheer squad coordinator Marcy Blake takes charge of the club's princesses.
Myself, with auditions, we have a lot of girls that audition, but I also want, besides good dancers, somebody that likes to perform and enjoys the Broncos, because why are you going to be out here all day when you don't enjoy the game?
A flick pass in the boardroom during the off-season. Colourful publican Paul Pookie Morgan takes over as chairman from Barry Moran. The Broncos have a new theme song for 92, as well as a new skipper, Alfie.
There's a lot of players there that could lead the side, and I don't think I'll have any problems. And, you know, if I do, I think I've got a lot of players there to back me up.
And when it comes to recruiting players, nothing but the best. Australian prop Glenn Lazarus becomes the buy of the season, with expectations high.
I think so. You know, especially the amount of pressure that I received at the beginning of the year with being the great white hope, so to speak, and all this sort of thing about, you know, the Broncos winning premierships now, they've got, you know, a forward with a name and all this sort of thing. You know, it was just something that, you know, was putting a lot of pressure on me, and I spoke to Wayne about it and all that sort of thing, and he just said, you know, go and play the football. And you know, that was probably the main reason why it was so tough, you know, having to go out there and perform each week and keeping the crowds happy, I suppose, and all that sort of thing. But you know, on the other side, the club and the players helped me a lot. You know, they're just so easy to get on with, and made things a lot easier.
Pre-season, Brisbane makes the final of the World Sevens, only to lose to Wigan, or more correctly, Martin O'Fire.
Couldn't have landed for a worse player in opposition. O'Fire out to Betts. Betts steaming down the sideline. Langer to beat. Khan comes at him. O'Fire! O'Fire gets number four!
Well, it wouldn't be anyone else, would it?
And for the third time in 5 years, the Broncos reach the final of the knockout challenge, only to lose 4-2 to Illawarra.
There's the siren. Illawarra are the Cup champions of 1992.
So the months of hard work and preparations went on the line when the Broncos and Cronulla opened the season proper on a balmy March night at Lang Park. It took little time for the Broncos to display that the pre-season efforts had done a lot to dust off the cobwebs. Former Test star Tony Curry on the end of a 75-metre try.
Renner! He's got support! Left and right! Curry's gone in field! Now he's come back! Eddie Howson can't get him! And Curry! Curry! Puts it down!
The match also confirmed what much of Brisbane had suspected. Versatile youngster Julian O'Neill was one out of the top drawer.
This is O'Neill, does a few steps on one blade of grass, then makes the split, still going. Eddinghausen's coming over, he kicks to the centre, Renoff gets a bounce, Renoff scores a sensational try.
The Broncos kept their line intact, victory theirs by 30-2, and the first of a long stretch of hurdles had been cleared.
I just wanted to get away to win, to get some confidence behind us, and to build on that.
Were you happy with that 28-point win?
Oh, yeah, I was elated with that. Yeah, it was a great start the season for us.
As had almost become habit, the Broncos once again began a season looking like world beaters. To date, the early promise had never been fulfilled. Was this season to be any different?
You want an unadulterated report here?
Yeah.
I think they suck.
Really?
Yeah.
Why do you say that?
Oh, I'm not a Brisbane supporter.
I don't think that they should win the premiership, actually. I think it would be very controversial if they did.
Why?
Because they're not from New South Wales.
March 29, 1992, the Broncos take on the Seagulls. Wally Lewis leads the side onto Lang Park for the final time. Back on the turf he'd made his own, Lewis tried inspiring his Seagulls with vintage defence. It worked. The Coast twice skipped away to handy breaks over the home team. In fact, when Danny Peacock strolled through some ordinary defence by Kevin Walters, an upset was imminent. However, the big and the small of Brisbane responded. Glenn Lazarus barged over before Alfie sealed it for the Broncos.
He's through. He's got him. Alfie's done.
His former halfback partner had denied Wally a winning farewell on his favourite ground.
I was disappointed that I'd lost. You know, I sort of hadn't really thought of the last game at Lang Park thing. When I walked off and waved to the crowd, it was sort of thanks very much for the memories, the good times.
The life I love is making music with my friends.
The early explorers may have done it a bit rougher, but they would not have covered any more territory than the Brisbane Broncos. Since the club's entry into the Sydney League 4 years ago, they've made over 60 trips to Sydney, played matches from Darwin to Dubbo, even strutting their stuff on the hallowed turf of the Adelaide Oval. In total, they would have covered almost 100,000 kilometres in the name of the game. Each of the players has his own way of passing the time, either at the airports, in the air, or at the hotels. But is it all a bit of a hassle? Chairman Paul Morgan.
No, not now. They know what it's all about. They're professionals.
Financially, is it?
Financially, it's a pain in the neck.
Hear, hear from some of the team punters.
Seven. Oh. Hey! Oh. Made a one.
Small biggies, though, in comparison to the total outlay. John Rebo.
Well, on the on travel, on the ticketed price, we spend around in excess of $600,000 a year, $600,000 to $700,000 a year.
Usually, the team arrives in Sydney approximately 24 hours before their game, be it a Friday night or Sunday afternoon encounter, and the routine is something the players have become used to. The bus trip to the matches is when the intensity, for some, not all, begins to rise.
Everyone's pretty quiet in the bus, listen to a bit of music or whatever, and just prepare for the game.
The pre-match necessities take place with a platoon of support staff vital in helping keep the players focused. Rarely are the Broncos made feel welcome. That only makes a victory all the sweeter. Another successful smash-and-grab raid completed, the Broncos return home. Not always looking quite as sharp as when they left, but nevertheless delighted to be back in friendly territory. No chance of the Broncos getting lost on their first away trip of 1992. They're off to the nation's capital, and with them their newest recruit, one of Canberra's proudest sons. Bruce Stadium and the Canberra Raiders awaited the Broncos. And for Glenn Lazarus, perhaps his season's biggest test. After helping snare two premierships for the Green Machine, Big Lazo was back in town to take on his former teammates.
It was a funny feeling. Obviously, I'd spent 6 good years there, and to play against them and have to bell them was certainly a different scenario that I used to do. You know, although it was good. I'm glad we won both times. It was good to beat them. I had no comebacks.
The match was also a coming together of the Walters clan. Brotherly love momentarily forgotten as Stephen gave Kerrod something to ponder. Lazarus was also afforded a less than cordial welcome home by Paul Osborne. In the end, Kevin Walters had the last laugh, scoring a double as the Broncos won 24-16.
Kevin Walters tries to do it himself.
The Broncos' first three matches had yielded victories. Now came the crunch against Premiers Penrith. It was at Lang Park, but on a Saturday, a day which hasn't been kind to Brisbane in the past. For the Broncos, race day was again to prove unkind. Fullback Paul Hoff suffering the start of chronic shoulder problems which prematurely ended his season. And it was the blood, sweat and tears of Mark Geyer and the genius of Greg Alexander which sent the Broncos plummeting to their first defeat.
That should be a match-winning try. And a
the Broncos headed to Brookvale next and the clash against Premiership heavyweights Manly. Two of the comp's more attacking sides traded tries early before Brisbane wrapped up the match 28-12. Willie Kahn on the end of another gem. Came the match many say was the turning point for Brisbane. Newcastle at Marathon Stadium. Chris John summed up the performance.
But I was out with a knee injury and they went down to Newcastle and I thought they played tremendous football down there at Newcastle. They really stuck to their game plan. It was a war of attrition and they came out on top. I thought it was a tremendous effort.
The match was low on points but high on tension. Alan Langer once again proving the difference.
I'll tell you what's on. Try about 6 points. Try four with a kick.
It was time for Alfie and a few of his mates to translate those skills to the representative arena. League's most famous contest was about to begin. The cane toad up against the cockroach.
I was cleaning my army fridge the other day, you know what I saw? What? The New South Wales back line in a practice session.
8 Broncos won selection for game one at the football stadium. Two of Brisbane's Bash and Barge brothers, Glenn Lazarus and Trevor Gilmeister, having to confront each other in opposite packs.
He's got another blue jersey on, mate, and once you're out there playing, play your normal game. Don't hold back.
We're all very professional players. We know that there's Australian jumpers up for grabs in the course of the series, we'll all go in as hard as possible, but I'm sure after the game we'll all have a beer together.
The Raiders' Bradley Clyde showed no embarrassment at standing up his club skipper, Mal Meninga. And the Broncos' halves combination were also ready to display the benefits of knowing each other's games. And again, it was a Broncos duo which helped post the Maroons' only four-pointer of the game. All to no avail, though. Craig Salvatore's second half try ensuring a Blues victory.
Craig Salvatore is in, and New South Wales slip to a lead of 12 points to 6.
No joy for Queensland. And from former Origin coach Wayne Bennett, complaints that the league has created a major problem in the scheduling of representative matches.
They've got to come up with a solution. Because, you know, this year we're in the playoffs. I felt we should have been there another couple of years, and the only thing that's ever stopped us from being there is the representative season. Canberra have now missed out. The representative season with injuries to Daly and other players has absolutely killed them. And, you know, they're not getting the best teams in the playoffs.
Balmain coach Alan Jones sees only one solution, and the Broncos had already looked after that.
Well, there is one way around it. That's to make sure you win early, and I think that's what the Broncos did. I mean, you've got to get enough points up early on. You can't forfeit games you should have won.
Game two. Steve Renoff is dropped, and Willie Kahn is out through injury. The match is a testament to Lang Park's favourite son.
Everywhere, will you join me in congratulating the Emperor of Lang Park on a great career?
Langer again showed he's not a pretender to the throne.
Big stop, Alan Langer.
Billy Moore scored for Queensland, and the Maroons nearly wrapped up the match, but for the fact Ricky Stewart spoiled the charge of his clubmate. At 4-all, the occasion called for a Hollywood finish, an Oscar-winning performance from Langer.
Langer kicks it. It's over. Is it? Yes! He's kicked it. Alfie Langer has kicked it.
The king is dead. Long live the king.
Yeah, that's my first field goal. I usually go along the ground or something, but I was happy with the one tonight, so I'll live on that one.
For the decider, Trevor Gilmeister unluckily loses his spot, but the Broncos' contribution isn't diminished. Chris Johns called into the Blues squad on the wing. His reading of a Langer play preventing a certain try. After the heroics of Lang Park, this was not to be Alfie's night. Uncharacteristic errors from the Maroons' linchpin, and to add salt to the wound, his opposite number untroubled to score for the Blues. Andrew Ettinghausen's second half try nailed the 1992 Origin coffin shut.
He's got it back to Daly to Ettinghausen. That's a try. Yes, New South Wales. Andrew Ettinghausen is in to score.
New South Wales 16-4 win, giving them the series. Club commitments must still take a back seat with the upcoming Ashes series. Broncos win four spots in the first test team. Langer, Lazarus, Hancock and Walters. An inconvenience to the club, but one of which they are very proud. In the midst of this heavy representative schedule, the Broncos were keen to avenge their Tuis Challenge final loss to Illawarra at Lang Park in round 7. But it was to be one of those days, where the bounce of the ball would favour the Steelers. Firstly, New South Wales centre Paul McGregor emerged from a mad scramble to score the opening try.
Ball rolls loose. They still come away, but it'll be McGregor going in, and that's a good try for Illawarra.
Then, with the match hanging in the balance, a perfect bounce saw John Cross score the match winner. The Steelers home by 2 points. Next, the Broncos ventured to new territory, South Australia's home of cricket, the Adelaide Oval, for the game against St George. The Dragons stole the show with their padded Lycra shorts, while the lights went out early for Kevin Walters.
John.
Replacement winger Pat Savage underlined the club's depth with a double.
Savage! He gets a double!
The Broncos established a match-winning break, but the Dragons laid on two of the best tries of the season.
Positioned in beautiful.
Rabbit was on the menu in round 9. Reserve grade half John Plath filled in for Langer and showed he too has the ability to create opportunities for teammates.
And that is champagne stuff. He finally puts it down.
But it was once again the attacking ability of Julian O'Neill which stole the show. Brisbane winning 26-18.
Has he got the strength? He's got both. And he's got the try.
The Broncos clambered through the first part of the rep season with two wins from three games, leaving them tied at the top of the table with Eastern Suburbs. Balmain held sole possession of third, with six other teams within one win of fourth spot. A telling sign of the Broncos' depth was the fact they were running second in the club championship. The second half is when rugby league games are won. The Broncos had impressively negotiated the first half of the premiership season. The refs were just about to blow the whistle for the crucial second period. After victories over St George and Souths, the Broncos were confident of making it three in a row against Canterbury at Belmore. In 92, the Bulldogs had been big on bark but light on bite. But with Rothmans medalist Ewan McGrady and skipper Terry Lamb leading the way, they gave the Broncos an early nick. While that deadly duo did their share of damage, the ultimate knockout blow came from Queensland origin player Darren Smith. The second of his tries saw Canterbury inflict Brisbane's third loss of the year.
Here's a go for the corner. It's gone to Darren Smith. That's it. That's it.
Against Norths, the Broncos' job was made all that much easier when Gavin Jones was sent off early for a high tackle. Wearing an unfamiliar jersey, Langer was still able to weave his magic against the Bears.
Yes! Oh, gee! He's weaving his own magic again!
With a sensational try to winger Michael Hancock, Brisbane enjoyed an 18-point lead before a gallant North made it a more respectable 28-22. Against one of the Broncos' traditional bogey sides, Balmain, Kerrod Walters stood out. His break, setting up Langer.
He's over the front line. There's no one within Kiwi of him. Over underneath the post.
Brisbane won 26-10. But the match will be remembered more for an incident involving Steve Roach. His stomp on Mark Hone later incurred a six-week suspension. In round 13, Alfie was given a rest. And on a damp Parramatta stadium, the Broncos proved too slippery for the Eels, who gave Willie Carn some room in his part-time role as fullback.
Erickson! Erickson! No! No hope! Oh, Parramatta, Shady Mahal! And Carn said, thank you very much.
The loss at Belmore was the Broncos' only blemish in June. Three wins from four starts gave them a four-point buffer at the top of the table over Easts and reigning premiers Penrith. A couple of other out-of-towners, Newcastle and Illawarra, complete the five. While the team surged upward and onward, the club was looking outward, outward to the suburb of Nathan and the QE2 Stadium. The long-running battles between the Broncos and the Lang Park Trust came to a head in 1992. For a number of reasons, the Milton headquarters did not suit the plans of the club, looking to the 21st century.
I don't like it at all. I don't think it's right.
Great idea. Should have happened years ago.
The atmosphere here is pretty spectacular at times, so could be missed, yeah.
The Broncos are shifting to the 1982 Commonwealth Games site because of a long-standing feud with the Lang Park Trust over money matters. Broncos chairman Paul Morgan has no doubts he's done a better deal with Lord Mayor Jim Sawley over the council-owned land and outlined the advantages for the spectators.
Number one's accessibility. Number two's comfort. Number three, they won't be harassed by drunken idiots, as we've seen just recently at Lang Park. There are a number of things, Bill, but you know, the main thing today is that the paying public will not accept second-class facilities. We believe we can give them first-class facilities at QE2.
The New South Wales Rugby League has accepted the QE2 proposal, but General Manager John Quayle will be keeping a very close eye on improvements which are needed to bring the ground and facilities up to A-grade standard.
We're yet to see QE2 developed, but I think when you look as far as a sport like ours is concerned, if you can get a greater facility with a better public convenience, you've got to look at it. It's no different to what we did in Canberra, going from Seaford Oval to Bruce Stadium. People were anti it and said it wouldn't work, but it has.
The people who have to adapt to their new home best are the coaches and the players.
Lang Park's been very close
to me personally. I've had a great time there as a player and as a coach. The decision was made by the directors because they believed it was in our best interest to do it. Really, my attitude always been that, you know, they run the board, they run the club, I run the footy team, neither of us interfere with each other. And if that's what they believe is best for us and that's where we're going, that's fine with me. There's no problems.
You know, Lang Park's been great. Now, they obviously see a financial reason in the switch, and I don't think they'll be any easier to beat there than Lang Park.
Roosters coach Mark Murray knew how potent the Broncos could be at Lang Park. July 5 and his East side arrived to a cool day and a hot Brisbane. It was a top-of-the-table clash, but the class difference was obvious. As is their habit, the Broncos turned desperate defence into devastating attack. In the 46-22 romp over the Roosters, Brisbane ran in 8 tries, none better than Julian O'Neill's.
Julian O'Neill has been there for 60 seconds and he's in.
The offensive skills earned praise from Balmain coach Alan Jones.
They simply have turned attack into the best form of defence, and I think that's where they changed the face of the game, and I'm really pleased that they have.
In round 15, West's premiership survival hinged on a win over the competition leaders. An early try lifted spirits at Campbelltown.
The big man will score! Never gets it down! That's the equaliser!
A frustrated Alan Langer aired his feelings and earned a rare stint in the sin bin. That mattered little to the outcome. The Magpies too strong on the day. Most expected the Broncos to hit back by crushing bottom side Cronulla, further flattened through injury. But only some Langer ingenuity lifted Brisbane to a hollow 20-16 victory.
And try.
On the 26th of July, the Broncos headed to the Tweed for Wally Lewis's last game against his old club. The King played down the importance, but actions speak louder than words.
Lewis goes for the line. He's reaching out as he got it this time. Referee is checking, and it will be a tie this time.
There was to be little further joy for Lewis, with Langer leading Brisbane to a 30-10 success over its nearest neighbour.
The pass gone inside the hand, John. Oh, they're good, aren't they, with the ball in the hand, Brisbane.
Just 5 fixtures remaining, and even the most pessimistic Broncos fan would have to accept that the team are certainties for the finals. A 4-point lead was enough for some to be already celebrating a minor premiership.
It's the most important date on the rugby league calendar. Grand final day at the Sydney Football Stadium. After months of toil, tears and triumph, just 2 teams out of the 16 remain in contention. It's down to St George and the Brisbane Broncos. And for the Broncos, on their way to rugby league history.
Broncos fans may have been outnumbered at the football stadium, but they weren't about to be intimidated.
Hi-ho, it's off to work we go. We're Brisbane Broncos on the go. Hi-ho!
And back home at Gilbert Park, all manner of supporters were among the thousands on hand to cheer Brisbane's pride and joy. Club chairman Paul Morgan and his predecessor Barry Maranta looked like men who'd waited 5 years for this opportunity, while the Broncos' chief sponsor was forking out yet again.
I'm just going to buy my flag.
The team arrived just 90 minutes before kickoff. 2 players with grand final experiences at other clubs, Kevin Walters and Chris Johns, leading the way. Alan Langer wore as intense a look as you're ever going to see on the little bloke, while Coach Bennett warmed to the greetings of well-wishers. Inside the stadium, the first blow of the day struck by the Dragons. Captain Michael Beatty calls correctly, and the Broncos will kick off in the biggest game of their lives. What a day from George of little consequence. 28-8 the final score, and the 1992 win. Most emphatic and entertaining fashion. The Brisbane Broncos had completed their journey on the road.